Welcome once again to Masterclass in Biology. We are continuing with our discussion on the most valuable questions. And these are the questions that are most likely to appear in the NEET entrance examination. And therefore, as always, the discussion will be around your NCERT textbook. And we are discussing strategies for enhancement in food production. We have already discussed about the animal breeding part and the animal husbandry part. In this video, we will talk about the plant breeding section in this chapter. Now, let us go straight away to NCERT. Like in animal breeding, the first question would be that you improve the genotype of a plant, of a crop, to get a better phenotype. This thing would be called as breeding. So breeding is improvement of genotype in order to get a better phenotype, and similar to the animal breeding, the same thing is going to happen in plant breeding as well. Obviously, you know that it is actually an interaction of a genotype and an environment that is responsible for the formation of a perfect phenotype. And if the genotype is good, then you do improved management practices to improve the environment. So question number one. Question number two would be that why do you want to actually do this? So what would be the purpose? Obviously, the first purpose that is absolutely clear is that we want to increase the yield of the crop, because for the simple reason that the population is increasing and we have to feed an increasing population, and therefore the productivity has to increase. The clever application of science and technology should provide more yield. This is the one aspect where we actually want to improve the crop. The second aspect would be that we want the crop to be very sturdy. So that means the environmental stresses, they should be able to combat the environmental stress better. So availability of water, drought, etc., salinity, if we are able to improve the crop and they are able to withstand these environmental extremes, then it will be actually increasing the productivity again. The third thing would be that there can be a problem of disease. So that means somehow you want to make the plant to disease, plants disease resistant. So that means the pathogen will not be able to create a problem in the plant, will not be able to actually lead to the loss of the crop. Because anything, if a plant is susceptible to a particular disease, you can easily understand that this can lead to devastating loss in the crop and therefore decreases the yield again. And similarly, there is another problem in crops, which is about the pest. So therefore we want pest resistance. So this is something that we need to consider. Moreover, I also want that now it is possible that let us increase the nutritive value of the crop plant. And somehow if we are taking care of the proper nutrition of the population, and the common plants now have the essential minerals and nutrients, and by the process of biofortification we are able to improve the crop, we will be able to give a more balanced diet to the malnutrited large proportion of our population. So this would be the basic idea that why actually you want to improve the crop. Now again, unless and until there is genetic variability, you will not be able to improve a crop. So the first thing is that if you want to improve a crop, there has to be genetic variability. Suppose a crop is having a good yield but is susceptible to a particular disease, then there must be some variety of this crop that must be disease resistant. It doesn't matter whether the yield is okay or not, but in the gene pool of this crop there must be the variability present. Otherwise you will not be able to improve the crop. Please try to remember this. If the variability is not present, you will have to create the variation. But the cornerstone of any plant breeding program would be an effective germplasm collection. So this is what your NCERT is saying, that you actually collect the variability, collect the germplasm. This is absolutely must, and you increase the variability. Say for example, by hybridization, you can increase plant introduction, you can do soma clonal propagation, you can actually do genetic engineering, so many things, you can induce mutation, but there has to be variability. And an effective germplasm collection is the primary requirement for a crop improvement program. And then obviously when you are going for classical hybridization experiment, then say for example in our case, I said that the plant is actually good in yield but is having having a problem with a certain pathogen and gets diseased easily. So this plant has good yield, but there is a problem of disease that occurs here. So I have chosen another plant, and this plant actually may or may not be good in yield, but obviously has disease resistance. So this is what I am trying to do. You know about the artificial hybridization experiment in sexual reproduction in flowering plant, how emasculation, bagging, and how cross-pollination can be achieved. Now, basically, these parents must be very carefully selected, and whenever possible, a continuous inbreeding in them will create homozygosity, and you like to create pure line because that will avoid segregation, and therefore this step becomes very, very critical step. And then the artificial hybridization, once you have carefully selected the parent, and then you achieve the cross-pollination, and it may take a lot of time. It is not a very, very straightforward process. It is actually a tedious process. It is time consuming, it requires a lot of man hours, and therefore should be done very meticulously. Now, after that, obviously this crop will lead to certain progeny, and in these progeny you are looking for the recombinants. And what are these recombinants? That means they have the combination of both an increased yield and disease resistance. Mind you, there can be more than one. So it is very important. This has to be very, 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 very meticulous process. It is this process that actually improves the crop. So once you select a superior recombinant that has the desired traits that are present in it, so actually you are improving the crop. But there can be more than one. So this is something. Please try to remember this, that there can be more than one. And obviously, now the diligence has to be paid that which is the best of out of them. So there are so many testings done, and then you select the best plant amongst the progeny that you think has the best capabilities, has the desired characters, and hence this selection becomes a critical process in the improvement of the crop. And then you test this particular cultivar again, you induce the homozygosity. So once you have selected the superior recombinant, then you actually induce homozygosity. Again and again we are saying that inbreeding actually is required. When you think of inbreeding, you think only of inbreeding depression, which is actually a disadvantage. That would be a narrower aspect of looking at inbreeding, has a very important role to play in breeding programs. Now, then you test it. Test the variety that you have improved. Now, first you test it in research fields and under ideal conditions. And then when you are satisfied, then introduce it into the farmer's field. Again, this is the part of the testing, and three growing seasons are normally selected for the duration for which you actually are going to test this particular crop, and different agroclimatic zones, and then you compare with the best local available cultivar, and then when you are satisfied, you release the crop to the farmer. So this is what NCERT is saying. So I hope this is now absolutely clear. We talk about green revolution. And now Norman Borlaug, the father of Green Revolution, working in Mexico, and this is where International Center for Wheat and Maize Improvement, Sonalika and Kalyan Soma, they were introduced into India. So they were introduced into India. Please try to understand this. Semi-dwarf rice variety from IR8 and from Taichung Nating 1, these were introduced and later improved. And these later improved varieties are called as the Jaya and Ratna. This would be in case of rice. So now we have understood about the varieties of wheat and varieties of rice. What exactly is the correct picture? What was introduced? What are the improved varieties of rice called? What are the parental stock? I hope this is now absolutely clear. Now please try to remember all these factual information. When it comes to sugarcane, then Saccharum berberi was not having a very good yield. It was able to grow in north, but the problem was there. Saccharum officinarum was not able to grow in north, and you did the classical hybridization experiment, and there was a recombinant that was actually able to grow in north as well and was having a thick stem and higher sugar content. Now, what I am trying to emphasize here is that this is all factual. This is a fact sheet that you must have made, and therefore please try to do these facts again and again. I am not wasting time in MVQs in the facts. So there are some tables that you will have to remember. I am just giving you the conceptual idea that what is the concept behind it. And when you look for plant breeding for disease resistance, there would be two methods. So there would be two methods. One would be the conventional hybridization. So one would be the conventional hybridization method, conventional breeding. And here comes the role of wild varieties. So wild varieties are very, very important if you are looking for disease resistance as a trait that you want to introduce in your crop and improve it. And if you look at another method, this is very, very important in plant. This is called as the mutation breeding. And please remember, these mutations will always be induced mutations. They are based on the fact that they occur at a faster rate, and a very good method to induce a mutation in plants would be the gamma rays. So you create gamma grade gardens and irradiate the seeds with gamma rays to induce mutation. And these mutations will be similar to the mutations that are created spontaneously, but they are occurring at a faster rate. So you cannot depend on spontaneous mutation. You have to induce mutation. So therefore, now when we are thinking of breeding for disease resistance, the basic concept is either you do a conventional hybridization or you do mutation breeding. And what is the importance of wild varieties and the induced mutations? Now again, you will have to remember, these tables. So I am not wasting time writing it here. This is the table that I am showing you. Any question can come directly here. And about the Abel Moschus, Esculentus, Moong Bean, how were these disease resistant varieties created? This is simple factual question and you will have to remember it. So we are moving on. And then obviously when I told you that this would be the resistance to the plant pest. So now we are seeing at yield, then we are looking at disease resistance, and now we are looking at the pest. So if the pests are something that damage the crop, so anything is a pest. So insect is a pest, rodent is a pest. So there are so many pests that are able to actually destroy a large part of the crop and thereby causing economic losses as well. Now when you look at the resistance, so this resistance can be because of morphological. So it can be because of morphological reasons. So morphological reasons, there can be some physiological things in which you know that it can be resistant to the pest. So that means we are looking at morphological, we are looking at physiological, and we are looking at the biochemistry. So these are the methods by which pest resistance is present in the plant. So now when it says something about a cotton and cereal leaf beetle in wheat, so you can understand hairy leaves. So this becomes a morphological feature that for which actually because of this it is actually protected from the particular pest. Again, please try to make a fact sheet and try to remember all these important questions, direct questions, nothing is to be explained right here. You go through the lines, you make a fact sheet, table 9.2, there are certain columns given, you have to remember them. A question can be asked directly from this part of NCERT. Now, as I told you, improving the food quality. So there is a hidden hunger. So hidden hunger would be because of the deficiency of these micronutrients, proteins, and vitamins. So look at the word which is called as hidden hunger, and we are talking about micronutrient, protein, and vitamin deficiency. Now the problem is they may be consuming enough calories in some cases, but still there may be a deficiency in these particular disease. You already know about protein, energy, malnutrition, the two variants of it, kwashiorkor and marasmus. A large population of our country is having malnutrition, and there was a very, very big problem of endemic hypothyroidism, endemic goiter in certain parts of our India because of the lack of iodine. And therefore the idea was that somehow you have to provide these micronutrients as well. So quantity and quality in food is very, very important, and right quality and as well as right quality quantity actually makes what is called as a balanced diet. It must have all the essential micronutrients. Obviously, protein is a very, very big problem, and vitamins, because vitamins are actually acting as coenzymes, if you remember, biomolecules, and therefore they are very, very important in the metabolic reactions that are taking place in the living body. So all these considerations have to be kept in mind. And if you are increasing this with the help of the plant breeding, you will call it as biofortification. So please remember, this is not adulteration, this is fortification. So if something is added to a crop for a nefarious design, for a criminal activity, it will be called as adulteration. But this is improving the quality, adding the nutrient value to a particular crop, and this is biofortification. And obviously, why the people are suffering from hidden hunger? Because they are poor. And suppose you actually start improving the crops which are very exotic and are very, very costly, then there will be problem. Nobody is going to eat it. So the idea is that the crop that you want to select for biofortification should be fairly common, should be easily accessible to the poor people as well. That is why we actually iodized the common salt, and therefore that iodized salt was used by everybody, and the problem has been substantially taken care of. And similarly, as you can see, you have improved the maize for tryptophan. Can you tell me that if we fortify maize for tryptophan, what important disease can be prevented in certain areas? So in India, somewhere around Andhra and Telangana, maize is the staple diet, and it is deficient in vitamin tryptophan. It can lead to a deficiency of niacin, and this can cause pellagra, which is characterized by 3 Ds, diarrhea, dermatitis, and dementia. And if you are using this maize hybrid, then obviously you can overcome it, and you can easily understand about Atlas 66. And Atlas 66, now nobody is eating actually Atlas 66. It has a high protein content, and then it has been used as a donor for improving the cultivated wheat. So whatever wheat is cultivated, it can be used as a donor. Now please remember, iron fortified rice, and very importantly, vitamin A enriched rice, where a gene for beta carotene, which is a precursor of vitamin A, has been introduced into rice variety, and a very, very important thing. And then you can see the common vegetables have also been fortified. Again, it is your duty to please remember the facts, and once you actually look at the factual biology, you will have to repeat it again and again. Only then it will become a part of your memory, otherwise there will be problem. Now, single cell protein, as the name suggests, is not actually a single cell. It is actually a biomass of microbes. So because microbes grow very fast, and if certain microbes in their biomass have high protein content, this can take care of the problem that we are facing with the protein malnutrition in our population. So please remember, it is actually a biomass. Yes, it is generated from the microbes, but the name single cell protein actually does not mean that it is only a single cell that is actually given to the people. So basically it is a biomass, and it is generated like this. Please try to remember that they grow very, very fast, and the problem with conventional things would be that 3 to 10 kg of grain would produce 1 kg of meat. And this is what it is saying, that a microbe like Methylophilus methylotropus, in the same period, this same period is when a 250 kg cow produces 200 gram of proteins per day, in the same period 250 gram of microorganism like Methylophilus methylotropus is expected to produce 25 ton of protein. So 200 grams and 25 tons. So the basic concept was that this reproduction rate is very, very high, and this spirulina is very important. It is a cyanobacteria. The problem with single cell protein is that they have high contents of the nucleic acids, and there is a problem with their taste as well. So they will have to be refined, and normally many of them are actually used as animal fodder. Now, plant tissue culture. So plant tissue culture is based on the property of cellular totipotency, and meristems are totipotent cells. So you take an explant, and this explant is moved into the culture medium. So let us look at the steps of the plant tissue culture rapidly. So we are saying that you take an explant, and this explant is the is the tissue or the cell or the organ that has been removed from the plant, and if it is meristem, it is very good. Otherwise, with the help of cytokinin, you can induce meristematic activity, and this is passed into a culture medium, and this culture medium will develop into an unorganized mass, which is actually called as callus. If the medium is liquid, it will actually grow faster, and then in this undifferentiated mass, you actually induce organogenesis. So this is one method of micropropagation. So micropropagation is a rapid clonal propagation. That means in a very short span of time, in a smaller space, you are able to generate hundreds and thousands of plantlets. Otherwise, it would have been very cumbersome. So if the plant is perfectly adapted, if the crop is very, very improved, and you can actually propagate it with these methods, you can actually get the plantlets in virtually very small period of time. And obviously, you can understand the impact that this is going to have on the crop yield of the nation. So please remember, micropropagation, the basic advantage is it is a rapid clonal propagation. We can get a large number of plants in a very short span of time. The second thing would be that, say for example, meristems are virus free. So the meristems are very, very fast dividing cells. They are resistant to virus infection. Many people hypothesize that because the plasmodesma are not very well developed, therefore this is one of the reason why they are resistant to the viral infections, and virus can cause havoc in plants. So if you want to generate disease resistant plants, actually meristem culture is a very, very good explant. So the second advantage of micropropagation would be that you can get disease resistance plant. The third is because the genetics is very simple. You can actually modify the genetics in the early stages, and you can actually create transgenics, and obviously you can actually store germplasm in the form of plant tissue culture, where say for example seeds of a plant are not storable. So these are the various advantages of micropropagation, and obviously this will give rise to soma clonal variation, because they are somatic clones. You are using explant, somatic cells as the explant, and because they are all clones, so they are called as soma clones. And even in this, because of the replication of DNA, there would be certain variations. These variations are called as soma clonal variation, and they can be used in the plant breeding program. So these are the advantages of micropropagation. And this organogenesis, you know, this is by Skoog and Miller, and we have already discussed it in the chapter on PGR. First, you regenerate the shoot with the help of a higher cytokinin, lower auxin ratio, and then you reverse it and get the roots, and then the equal proportion will lead to the proper establishment of the vascular bundle, and you get plantlets. You test the plantlets under adverse condition, low light, high humidity. This is what is called as hardening, and then again send them to the various agroclimatic zone, and if you are satisfied, obviously name it and look at the intellectual property rights, and then actually release it to the farmer. The second thing can be somatic embryogenesis. In certain cases, it is possible in plants that you take a somatic cell, and this somatic cell is actually kept in a higher concentration of auxin, like 2,4-D, and it can develop into an embryo, and these embryo will be called as somatic embryos or embryoids. So they are called as somatic embryos or embryoids, and obviously there is no need of then organogenesis, because this is an embryo, it will regenerate the plantlet. And this can be, these things can be actually very, very important in many cases. Say for example, interspecific hybridization has a barrier, so you can actually achieve the various things with the help of where there is a barrier. You can actually look at the cultures, and you can do embryo rescue. There are certain inhibitors that are present, and in certain cases, like in orchids, the embryo rescue type of thing has to be done, and these are the applications of plant tissue culture. We are not going into a lot of details. There is another thing, what is called as somatic hybridization. So this is somatic hybridization. So as I told you that interspecific hybridization may be a problem. So what can happen is you take two cells, two somatic cells of different plant species that you want to create an interspecific hybrid, and you convert these cells into protoplast, you remove the cell wall and use polyethylene glycol or electric shock to fuse them, and this would be protoplast fusion. And this type of thing would be, if it is able to regenerate the cell wall, then it can be transferred into a culture medium and the plantlets can be generated. Pomato unfortunately did not have the desired effects and has been discontinued. So let us go back to plant tissue culture and let us see, do we know all these terms? So that means now we have discussed what is tissue culture, explants, what is totipotency, what is micropropagation, what are soma clones, what is the advantage of meristem, what is somatic hybrids, what are somatic hybridization. So these are largely the questions that are likely to be asked in the NEET entrance examination, and we will continue with our MVQ series with another chapter very soon. Thank you so much.